right there. It means you're picking on my voice right now.
Good morning, everybody. We are glad to be here at St. Matthew's United Methodist Church. It's a beautiful Sunday morning. Thanks for being here with us. This morning, before we begin our time of worship, let's take a moment to welcome each other here to God's house. We come together to praise our God and to give worship to his name. So this morning, for our opening hymn of praise, we're going to sing hymn number 694. Come, be thankful for your coming. 694. We'll sing all the verses of this hymn.
Most supportive group of people that we have, and we could not continue to do all of the work at MadCap that we do without your help. Among your congregation is one of our best staff members and many, many wonderful volunteers. We could not run MadCap without all of the volunteers that give tirelessly from the St. Matthew's congregation. They open their hearts completely to everything that goes on there, and they just work tirelessly. And I wanted to say thank you to each one of you. You know who you are. I thank you, and I love you. You know, every fall at MadCap, we have over 200-plus women that flood through our doors to come and sign up for what we call Christmas classes. Many cannot read above the second grade level. Some people have managed to even graduate from high school not being able to read on a very high level. Most work minimum wage hourly jobs, and they work right up to that hour that they're still part-time and cannot become full-time with benefits. Almost all of them grew up in generational poverty. Generational poverty, when children of parents are now parents with children themselves. We see it every day at MedCap. They have lived in poverty so long that they don't have any family that has ever known anything differently. No other examples to follow, only those that have lived in poverty before them. Generational poverty produces hopelessness. It promotes surviving rather than planning. Often there is a lack of trust that is common among generational poverty. Values and patterns are molded from generations gone by of those that have lived in poverty before them. We believe through MedCap we are restoring hope and providing education to help raise those values. They learn to trust that their children will be provided for the holidays, through MedCap's Holiday Adopted Child Program and through St. Matthew's Birthday Gift for Christ. It's a way for you to make a difference in the life of that child. They did not ask to be born into poverty. They are simply a victim of their circumstances. When you look through their wish list, remember that you are their hope in what can be a very hopeless situation during the holidays. Do they pay rent or do they buy items for their children for Christmas? Do they buy food or do they buy presents for their children at Christmas? Shop for the child as though they won't have any other presents. It's likely they will not. You notice I didn't say presents under the Christmas tree. You know, a lot of our staff members and volunteers through the years, we go out during the holidays and actually go into people's homes, and it is seldom we really see a sign of Christmas, a Christmas tree, presents, decorations. So when I say shop for that children as though they don't have any other presents, it's because they likely will not have any other presents. Take that extra time to find that special color or that special cartoon character they've asked for or a random widget or whatever the latest and greatest toy is, because others will not do that. Others will say that's just good enough. We hear that day in and day out at MedCap. That's just good enough. They live in poverty. It's more than they have now. But you know what? That's just not good enough as those of us that give. While the holiday season is meant to be a joyful time, for most we assist, it is a time of great financial worry and uncertainty more than anything else. Each year at MedCap during the holidays, as staff members and volunteers, we always come up with aha moments. You know, we think we have figured it all out. Some of us have been there, myself 12 years, others volunteers 7, 8 years. And we think we have it all figured out until we come across another aha moment. And then we're just taken back. And we just really don't know how to respond. We're taken back this year by the 6-year-old boy that has put on his wish list, instead of toys, Rice Krispies, Frosted Flakes, orange juice, and milk. We are taken back by his request. We are taken back by the teenage girl that has listed a whitening toothpaste as a gift that she wishes for. We are taken back by whitening toothpaste. We are taken back by the mother that battles cancer that has asked for special request that is protein drinks so that she can gain weight and hopefully beat cancer. We are taken back by protein drinks. These things often remind us what we too simply forget. What we need to do is the right thing. To bring them hope to the children and their mothers in what could be a holiday filled with their hopelessness. So be a life changer, if you will. Thank you.
Thank you. poverty of those who all have ever known as poverty. Their parents before them were poor. They are poor. They're raising their children in poverty. Okay. So, I'm a hard worker. Because I saw my dad get up every night at 11 o'clock in the morning, drive for 8 hours, come home, go to bed, wake up about the time I got from school, lather, rinse, repeat every day. I saw a model for me hard work. We didn't have much, but I saw what that looked like. I had an example. For those in generational poverty, do they sometimes make poor decisions? Yes. They sometimes do things that we think they shouldn't do. Yeah. But that child did not choose to be born into that context. And if all you've ever seen is that, and all your parents have ever seen is that, and all you see lying ahead of you is that, you're just trying to get to the next day. That is the best reasons of poverty I've ever heard. And those of us who have been blessed by nothing more than birth, who have been shown good examples, Scripture says we're supposed to help each other out. We have so much to be thankful for. And so I think as we enter into the season of thanks, we are reminded of just how fortunate we are. We don't have everything we need. We don't have everything we want. But we're doing okay. Let's be especially mindful in this Thanksgiving and Christmas season of those that have, that all they have ever seen is poverty. And as far as they can see ahead of them, all they see ahead of them is poverty. Because they've never seen another example but that. That is generational poverty. And that's what we as the church can work with to help those, particularly those who need. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the blessings you've given us. God, you have shown and given us so much. And we are so thankful for all that you have given to us. God, give us in this season thankful hearts. And give us grace to be thankful in all things, Father. God, we do ask you now to be with those in need in this season. Father, we ask you to continue to bless our worship, to continue to bless, God, your room and the Spirit here at St. Matthew's. God, use us in some great way today and in the days to come. Father, we ask you to be now with all those who need your grace, those hurting, those lonely, those grieving, those afraid and alone. Give them. Pray, God, for our country. For all the forces, Father, pray especially for those in our military who are away from family on this Thanksgiving season. God, be with them who cannot be with loved ones Thursday. Father, we pray as well for our first responders, those who will be working in police departments, fire departments, medical professions. All those who cannot or are out of duty and out of work, be present with their loved ones this Thursday. Be with them. Pray, God, for all those that need to know they're not alone. Pray for all these, oh God, we pray for those whom no one else prays. Loving God, we do ask you now to forgive us of our sins, to make us ever mindful of your grace and love. We ask this morning, O God, not our name. We ask in the name of the Lord taught us to pray, as we say, our Father and Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
We are glad you're here with us this morning at St. Matthew's, and I hope as you came into worship this morning, you grabbed the newsletter. Always know your newsletter is one of the best ways to keep up with all the great things happening. And it's a busy season. As you can tell, when you look through your newsletter, there are a lot of activities. I can't take time to highlight all of them. I wish that I could. But there, so really take this. As I always say, if the sermon's boring, read through it. You'll have something for you to read during the sermon today. There are several things I do want to highlight to you this morning. First, know that St. Sunday is coming up very soon. The tree is out in the narthex. We're encouraging people to give food this year. And as you heard Karen say, for some of the families, that's what they're asking for. So we encourage you on St. Sunday to grab one of our stars out there and return on St. Sunday, the first Sunday of December, with this act of worship as we help each other, help those in need. So St. Nick's Sunday is coming up very soon. Poinsettias are for sale for UMW to benefit their ministry. We encourage you to buy a poinsettia in memory or in honor of someone. The children will be selling jambalaya tickets as a fundraiser in the next month. So we encourage you to support our children's ministry. And then I see Christmas with Santa is going to be something neat coming up in a few weeks. A great activity for our family. The newsletter tells all of this, so be sure to grab your newsletter. Okay. Now, if you're a guest this morning, I'm going to ask you, you don't have to do it literally, just metaphorically, put an earmuffs on. But if you're a guest this morning, or new to our church, I'm not talking to you right now. I love you, and I'm really thankful you're here, but if you're a guest, I'm not talking to you. So, St. Matthew's turn your card, Jim. Okay, now we did not do a great job in communication and things like that. Sorry. We probably should have done better. Y'all, we can't make a budget without these cards. We're better than this. Seriously. I know we're busy. I know we all got a lot going on. But if you're planning to give to our budget, do it. Because we have to run our budget together now. We might have to cut some stuff. A dollar's a dollar. So if you're a guest, feel free to ignore all this. Come on, St. Matthews. Seriously. We need to turn your cards in. You can turn it into the offering plate. You can go to the church office. You can give it to me. Whatever. But come on. We invite our precious athletes forward to receive the morning. make these our acts of worship, our gift, our task offers. Use them, O God, build good in your kingdom, so that all the world may come to know you as Lord. We ask in Jesus' sweet and holy name. Amen.
It's now time for the children's moment, so if the children would join me right up here. It's good to see everybody this morning. They're up here. Sorry. I kind of threw the curveball. Okay, so I want you, I brought a picture, but you can also look up on the altar. See all that? What is that? Yeah, I have a picture too. Do you know what that basket's called? A cornucopia, or also the horn of plenty. And what it is what's in it? Is that puppies and kittens? Wheat? Pepper. It's food, right? Right? It's all kinds of food and things that you can eat. And back a long time ago, they would collect food in these and at the harvest time, and it would show all that they had. And in America, we use it. Hello. In America, we use it at Thanksgiving because it's a good sign of having enough to eat. None of us have to worry about having enough to eat, do we? That's right. I mean, sometimes we get a little hungry, but we don't know what it's like not to have food coming. Right, John? You know what it's like to have a full belly, right? Yeah. And so they would do this to show the plenty that we have, because we do have plenty, and we need to be thankful for it. And what are some other things we can be thankful for other than food? What are some things you're thankful for? Ellen, from the crowd? What is she thankful for? Oh, okay. Family? Roof over your head? John? Family? Olivia? Oh, a safe place to live in a home. That's right. How about your church? And who gives us all that we have? God. That's right. And we can be thankful for Jesus. John, you are so smart. And everyone. We need to be thankful for everyone. And how do we show God that we're thankful? We love the people around us, and we come to church, and we pray. All of those things we can show. And yes, and we tell him we love him. Oh, y'all are having wonderful ideas. Yes, right. That's right. So we need to make sure this week when we're celebrating Thanksgiving, we need to thank God, don't we? And there's a couple of things we can do that just this week that might help. First of all, we've heard about Birthday Gift of Christ, and we as the children of St. Matthew's have been asked to bring toothpaste. So you can bring toothpaste to church and share it with the family so another child can take care of their teeth. Isn't that nice? And then, also, if you are third grade or older, you can grab a parent and meet us here at 8 o'clock on Tuesday morning after tomorrow. We're going to go to MadCap and help pass out food for Thanksgiving so families will have a nice Thanksgiving meal just like your family. So those are different ways. And tell the people you love that you're thankful for them. Because sometimes it's nice just to hear that. Would anybody like to pray for us today? Let's see if somebody who hasn't prayed in a while. Okay, we'll let Olivia pray.
Thank you for our day. Thank you for our daily bread. Thank you for our family and our food. Thank you for our Thanksgiving food. Amen.
Reading today is from 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 1 through 11. If you'd like to follow along, you can find this on page 205 in the New Testament portion of your Pew Bible or on the word of the Lord. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. This is the word of the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
found that in your pew Bible or in your own back door of worship or your own personal Bible. That's the song we're looking at in Psalm number 66. Where the psalmist writes these words. Make a joyful Lord, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Because of your great power, your enemies are quaking before you. All the earth worships you. They sing praises to you. Sing praises to your name. Come, let's see what God has done. How awesome are his deeds among mortals. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed the river on foot. They were rejoiced in him, who rules by his might forever, whose eyes keep watch on the nations. Let the rebellious not exalt themselves. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living, who has not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You have brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our back. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, yet you have brought us into a spacious place. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will pay you my vows, those that my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. I will offer to you burnt offerings of fatness, the smoke of the sacrifice of rams. I will make an offering of bulls and goats. Come and hear, all who fear our God, and I will tell you what he is looking for. I cried aloud to him, and he was extolled in my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has given heed to the words of my prayer. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me. This is the word of God, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I've learned in life, in terms of sight, there's really two kind of people and two kind of mentalities when it comes to science. I was thinking about this past week, and I was having a conversation with a friend that teaches biology. And he was, because I guess the divergence is people who do science either love biology and hate chemistry, or vice versa. So I majored in chemistry, and I hate biology with the passion of a thousand white suns. I hate biology. I had to take to graduate to get out, and I complained the entire time, and I didn't like it, but I did it. I like chemistry. Chemistry makes sense to me. Biology doesn't. So because I see, like, in the biology setting, this friend of mine was telling me that he was in school, and he was in the deep freeze and found a turkey that was shot, that nobody claimed. So he said, ooh, we're going to dissect that. So he took this turkey that didn't belong to anybody to the class, and they plucked it, and they dissected it, and they looked at the innards, and they were happy. And I'm like, you should have eaten it. You got a turkey. I could have got you some grease. You could have fried that bad boy up and had a good time with it. Why would you waste a good turkey to dissect it? That's crazy. I like chemistry. Chemistry makes sense. Chemistry is clean. It's numeric. You do this to this equation, and this happens here. So you do this and this, and you get this. If you want to start here, you do this and this, and it all just kind of, makes sense to me. I like it. Chemistry is about formulas and about equations and about things working out. It just makes good sense to me. It's chemistry. It's kind of like calculus. The only class I ever dropped when I started the ministry was I was at Mississippi College, and I was in Calculus 3. And I started the ministry, and the next day I went to the dean's office, and I dropped that class like it was hot. I mean, because preachers don't need calculus. So I dropped that thing like it was hot. I said, I don't need it. I'm not taking it. I'm done. So that was one class I ever dropped after I started the ministry. But ironically, I took a life to have one that calculus is actually a helpful tool in ministry. Because calculus and chemistry both train your brain to think, okay, I do this, and this will happen, and this will happen, and this will happen. And every action has some affect upon something else. Everything's interconnected. And when you do this, it leads to this, it leads to this, it leads to this. And it's a good way to train your mind to think, to understand that every action has consequences, and everything flows together, and everything fits together. And everything has its place. That's true in ministry. That's true in life. And it's true in Thanksgiving. This passage we read today, Psalm 66, I think lays out for us a beautiful formula for Thanksgiving. I think this passage here really lays out for us some very helpful guides and tools that can help us be thankful. Because here's the reality. It might be hard to be thankful right now. Just turn on the news or fire up Facebook. Everybody's mad at somebody for something. Nobody's happy. I don't know a single person right now in the world that's happy. Everybody's angry. And a lot of it's for real. A lot of stuff is bad going on right now, y'all. And it's easy to get overwhelmed with the negativity and the struggles, the very real negativity, and the very real troubles in our world. So in a world where it seems like bad news just comes at us like a faucet, how in the world can we be thankful? How in the world can we have hope? How in the world can we be thankful in a time where it seems like negativity is just going to win? How can we have hope to rejoice as the animal was able to rejoice in the middle of things being bad? It's kind of hard sometimes to find that hope and to find that thanksgiving in these times. So I think Psalm 66 really lays this out for us. Thanksgiving, though, is an interesting concept. I wrote in front of the bulletin and I talked about our season of saints this past Thursday. It's interesting if you look at the life of our country, how Thanksgiving is a very American institution. Other countries do it, but it's really part of who we are. I love Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is my family's holiday. I mean, that's kind of our big holiday is Thanksgiving. Family comes up from New Orleans, we go down, we eat too much, we get angry with each other. It's great. I mean, we just love Thanksgiving. It's a great holiday for my family. And it's a very American holiday. And so you go back and you look at the history of Thanksgiving in the course of our nation. Go back, you hit rewind. Go back to our cute little kids, the pilgrims, and the Native Americans, and all the festivals and the fun. That was kind of the first Thanksgiving, was that early American colony season, where the pilgrims harvested the food, and they ate together and thanked God. And you know why they thanked God? Because they survived. The original Thanksgiving was not some kind of metaphorical thing for anything. They were literally thanking God because they were alive. And many of them may not make it through the coming winter, and they may not be there the next springtime to thank God again. The original Thanksgiving was literally about thanking God for having survived. So, hit fast forward. The next time Thanksgiving becomes cemented in the advent of America, it's going to be during the Civil War. Lincoln declares that the first Thursday of Thanksgiving in November is a time for all the states to stop and to have a time of Thanksgiving. That was what most historians feel like is the first modern American Thanksgiving, was Lincoln in the Civil War. And then fast forward to 1941. When FDR moved Thanksgiving from the first Thursday of November to the fourth Thursday of November. And that's kind of when the modern American holiday really was crystallized. Okay, three great movements of Thanksgiving in our country. The Pilgrims, Lincoln, FDR. What do we see happening in the life of our nations at each time? Suffering. War, intense poverty after the Great Depression, war raging across Europe, civil war wrecking our own nation, the pilgrims struggling to eke out a meager living. And in each time, in each of these moments, what was the impetus? What did they do? They stopped and they gave thanks to God. We do not thank God because our circumstances are good. We thank God because He is good. Thanksgiving is not done because our circumstance and our life is perfect. Thanksgiving is not done because everything that's great on our end. Thanksgiving is done because God is good. This mercy is new every morning. Thanksgiving is not about our life being perfect. Thanksgiving is about God's life being perfect. Every time Thanksgiving is cemented into the life of our country, it comes in a time of struggle and of pain because the people said, yes, life is hard, but God is good. Psalm 66 lays out for us a beautiful formula for Thanksgiving. So like with our equations in chemistry, you want to start here, you want to wind up here, do these things. You want to be thankful? Psalm 66 gives us three good things to be thankful for, ways to be thankful. First, we see the first 13 verses. We see it here when it says, come and see what God has done. This is verse 5. Come and see what God has done. Come and see how awesome are his deeds among the mortals. He has turned the sea into dry land. They have passed through the river on foot. Then verse 10 says, for you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as you have tried us as silver is tried. You have brought us into the net and laid burdens on our back. Let people ride over our heads. We went through the fire to the water. Yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. Verses 1 through 12 tell us the first step in the formula of thanksgiving is to remember. Remember what God has done, especially in times of suffering, especially in times of pain, especially in times of grief, especially in times of hurt. It's easy to forget what God has done. We can become so consumed by our circumstance. We can become so consumed by this moment. We can get so consumed by what's happening right now that we stop, but we do not stop and remember what God has done. Remember how God has sustained us. Remember how God has saved us. Remember how God has preserved us. It is so easy in the midst of life. It is so easy in the midst of pain. It is so easy in the midst of everything to forget. To forget just how good God is. To forget just how big his grace is. To forget just how merciful he is. So the first step in the formula of thanksgiving is to stop and remember. Remember how good God is. Count your many blessings. Name them one by one. Count your many blessings. See what God has done. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. The last time you put your phone down, turned off the TV, and you stopped and remembered just how good God has been to you. You ever think to yourself, I did this a lot. How did I wind up here? All the different decisions and turns. Moments that led us to this moment right now. It's by no accident we're here together, is it? Remember. The first step to be thankful is to stop. And just to remember how good God is. How God has preserved our life and kept us here. It's by him. Remember. Second step in the formula of thanksgiving, verses 13 through 15. I will come into your house for offerings. I will pay you my vows, those my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. I will offer you burnt offerings of fat. I will make an offering of bulls and goats. First, remember. Second, fulfill. Be true to the things that we have said we would do. Live a life of action. Sometimes when I'm working on a sermon, I get writer's block. I just don't know what I want to say. I know it's up here, but there's a disconnect between here and here. So what I do, I go walk around. So you may pull into church one day and see me walk around the front of the yard like a crazy person. Oh, Andy's wandered off again. Somebody go call Holly. I mean, that's what I do. I'll walk. I'll just walk the grounds. I'll walk out in front of the church. I'll be on the phone. I'll be moving. At one of the churches I was at, when I did writer's block, when I couldn't think, I'd go, not shoot free throws in the gym. I just sit there and shoot free throws. Just repetition, just movement, just action, just doing something to get the juices flowing, doing something to get moving, doing something to kind of get you out there doing something. If you're not thankful, go take protein drinks to the woman who all she's asked for was protein drinks so that she can maybe perhaps survive cancer. You don't feel thankful? Go take Rice Krispies to the child. That's all he's asked for this Christmas, is Rice Krispies. You don't feel thankful? Go do something for somebody. Take the attention off yourself. Take the attention off your problems. Take your attention off all the stuff going on in your life and do something for someone. Fulfill the promises that we have made to God to be faithful with our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. If step one is to remember, step two is to fulfill. You will never experience true thanksgiving if you are passive. You will never experience true thanksgiving if you're not doing something for somebody. I told the confirmation kids this morning that the quickest way to be miserable in your life, live only for yourself. Live only for your dreams and your desires and your wants, and make your life completely and totally about what you want to do. I give you my word for it. You will be miserable. Step one is to remember. Remember what God has done. Remember his goodness. Step two is to fulfill. Be faithful. Do something for somebody. Live out the promises that you made to God. Be true to your word. Be active. Get the juices flowing. Do something, and you will be thankful. Step three, you know what it says at the very end? Come in here, verse 16. Come in here, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I do way too much Facebook in my life. I probably need to be limited, like with our children or something. I like this time of year to watch people with their children. You know, I had a friend of mine yesterday that about 8 o'clock yesterday morning put on his Facebook wall, said, who knew Rice Krispies were so noisy in a shoe house? He's taking a little ball deer hunting. And she was just eating Rice Krispies and just making a big old racket. And she got saying, oh, should have left her home. 2 hours later, he showed a picture of her having killed her first deer. And there she was in front of him. He was so proud of her. Oh my gosh. He was so proud of her. He bragged on her so fierce. When was the last time you bragged on Jesus like that? I love seeing the selfies of our church during the week, ball games, different activities. We're so proud of the different things in our life. Do we tell others the same pride about what Jesus does in our life? Do we tell others the same pride about what Jesus is doing? We'll be thankful. Tell somebody about what Jesus is doing in his life. Brag on our restaurants. Brag on our accomplishments. Brag on our winning exploits. Brag on our shopping exploits. Get a lot of pictures on Facebook Saturday morning about people writing about the Black Friday shopping. Excited about their goods. I'm not telling you how to do it. In fact, I say, I'm going to sleep because I'm lazy. You do you. I'm going to sleep. But are we as proud of Jesus and what he's doing in our life as we are of these other things? And will we tell somebody about it? Will we tell somebody about it? Will we be thankful? Right now, speaks gives us a good recipe for it. Remember, fulfill. Remember what he's done for us. Fulfill, be able to live lives of action, and tell somebody about it. I'm a terrible cooker. I'm a good eater, but I'm a terrible cooker. So I don't get you cooked, man. All your recipes are a dab of that and a dash of that. I don't know what that means. I don't want to dab anything. Dab's not a word. Dab's not a word. Dash, I don't know what dash means. I need centimeters and measurements and inches and pounds and ounces and metric liters. I don't need dabs and dashes. I need specific instructions on how to cook something. Psalm 66 has given us specific instructions today on how to be that. So the question is, this week, will we follow the recipe? Will we be thankful people? Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for the gift of thanksgiving. Thank you for your love and grace and mercy. God, help us, oh God, to be truly thankful in all things, and to live in your power and grace. We love you. We ask in Jesus' sweet and holy name. Amen. Our closing invitation this morning will be a great Thanksgiving hymn. We gather together. Love this song. Hymn 131. We'll do the first, we'll do all the verses here. This morning, during our final song, the altar is open. Perhaps you've never made the decision to put your full faith in Jesus Christ. Today is a great day to accept Him as Lord and Savior. Perhaps there's something you need to pray about. There's something going on in your life that you need the church to wrap its arms around you and love you. The altar is open for prayer. Or perhaps I can learn more about how to join St. Matthew's. I would love to talk to you about how you can come into that church. This morning, no matter where you find yourself this morning, Jesus Christ stands here ready to meet you. Won't you come? Gracious God, go with us now. Let us live in your mercy, in your joy, in your peace, and in your grace. We love you so very much. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit, be about us each now and forevermore.
May the grace